All right, well, I don't have a little movie today, but today's also maybe a little bit shorter. It's kind of loaded with little movies. So today I'm going to cover the mammals that I see out there. And, we did a lot of different bird groupings. So I'm going to tack some songbirds on at the end because there's three that are very ostentatious out there. I mean, you see them all over. I'm sure there's many more that I'm not going to cover, but these are the ones you really see out there all the time. So I'm going to try to cover those three. Let's see. Uh-oh, that's a bad sign. Oh, there we go. All right, so river otters, these you do not see a lot of river otters, but they're out there. You just don't see them very easily. So this particular group was in a very small like lagoon coming out of the, yeah, coming out of the reeds and underbrush, and it's a what looks like a family of four. The otter will have 2 to 4 babies, and the babies will stay with them. Like it takes them about 2 months. You know how we talked about the geese and the swans? They're like ready to go. The minute they hatch, boom, they're in the water, they're gone. These guys take about 2 months to kind of get up to a stage where they can manage on their own, but they stay with the mom until the next set of babies is born. That can be, I don't know, 8 months or something. Interesting, here's a weird thing about the otters is the egg gets fertilized and it stays in the mom for like 10 months before it then implants in the uterus and then they develop and give birth. That's kind of a weird, I'm not exactly sure what that adaptation's all about, but that's the way the otters work. Now, this is some otters that I saw from a distance, and then they finally saw me. And I don't know if what they're doing is trying to make themselves look big and fearful or fearsome, or if they're trying to get up high to see, is this something in, that I should be worried about? Is this danger? Here, that same group in the middle of the river. Again, sticking his head way out. It's interesting because I just read that they're not particularly territorial, but I saw a video on Instagram maybe, I don't know, 3, 4 months ago, 6 months ago, of these two gangs of river otters in this very big river. Charging at each other from like a quarter of a mile away and doing the same thing where they're leaping out of the water and char and then clashing. So I don't know what that's all about if they're not territorial. That seemed a little odd. Here's an otter you'll see eating. See him with the fish in his mouth right there, swallowing it. This is in a lagoon kind of early in the morning, so the lighting isn't great, and so pictures are a little fuzzy. Here's another one. If you look way in the back, you'll see him eating.
Whereabouts on the Assabet is that?
Sorry, I can't see who's. Oh,
Whereabouts?
there you are. I couldn't see who was talking. So this was in two different, well, let's say two major areas. One area was this small lagoon next to this utility building, and I don't know what the utility building is. I don't know if any of you guys are familiar with the Assabet. So everything here is in Stowe. Have you not been to any of the previous talks? So I do everything that you see is starting at the Sudbury Road Bridge, right by corner Barton Road, down along Honeypot, along Collins Foundation. There's a big pond back there. There's a smaller pond back there. There's some back channels. The river kind of serpentines, and there's like a little utility building along this serpentine portion.
Okay.
And then if you keep going, you go past Railroad Avenue. And then if you go a little further, you start coming up to where the new construction's going on behind Forest Road. I don't go that far. So everything is in that stretch. This particular one that you're seeing came from that little lagoon by the utility building. I always assumed it was a Hudson Power and Light or something, but somebody else told me recently it's something else, and I've forgotten now what he said it was. Small lagoon there. The other ones, the one where you saw them kind of leaping out of the water, that was along the main big wide stretch of the river, right by the, across from the Collins Foundation, sort of alongside the honeypot fields. I kind of followed them because I saw them off on the side, and so I was kind of sort of drifting towards them, and at one point they got down to that spot where I got the really good videos. I stayed way back and started filming them, and I was filming them, and they were playing around and stuff, and then all of a sudden they saw me. And that's the little clip I'm showing you there. So they're like, let's say on average, like 20 pounds. So if you compare that to what I'm gonna, the beaver that's coming up, a beaver, believe it or not, the average is like 50 pounds. That's like a medium-sized dog. I mean, I'm surprised they're that big. And then you'll see the muskrat after that is only like less than 5 pounds. So, and a lot of times people confuse them because it's hard to tell the difference, and I'll show you the difference in a minute, but 5 versus 50, these guys are kind of in the middle, like 20 pounds. And by the way, these are the largest weasel. So they're in the weasel family, and they're the biggest weasel. And we'll see in a minute, the beaver is the biggest rodent, so. Okay. We're up to the beaver. Let me make sure there was nothing else with the river otter that we should talk about. So they have burrows along the shore, but they don't make their own burrows, which is kind of interesting. They either use other animals' burrows, or they use kind of areas that sort of feel like a burrow to them, but they don't actually dig a burrow themselves. They, of course, like heavy vegetation, which is fantastic for that stretch of the Assabet. I mean, you can't beat, that's why the wildlife is so great in that stretch, is because the vegetation is so thick, the river's shallow, it's perfect for animals. Let's see. Oh, that's interesting too. They mate in the water, under the water. Interesting. And almost everything they eat is fish. They'll eat some amphibians and mollusks, a little bit of opportunism, but mostly, like 80-90% of their diet is like fish. So the beaver, everybody's familiar with the beaver. Like I said, this is the largest rodent in North America. I don't think it's the largest rodent in the world. I think, is that like the capybara or something? I don't know, it's one of the other ones, but in North America, this is the largest rodent. So I guess it's average. The average weight's about 44 pounds for a beaver. I'm not sure that's even worth talking about. There's an interesting. Maybe I will talk about it for a second. There's an interesting rule in animals versus where they live. So if you're an animal and you live in the North Pole, you're going to be a large animal, but with small surface area relative to the size of your body. And that's because you're trying to retain heat and all that. If you're a animal living in the Sahara Desert, you're going to be small with a lot of surface area relative to your body because you're trying to, vent off heat. You're trying to regulate your temperature better. That's why a lot of animals have very long tails. That's a kind of a temperature regulating mechanism. So beavers adhere to this rule. So the farther north they are, kind of the bigger, fatter they are, the further south they are. I don't know if that's something of interest or not. I don't know if you're all aware, but all rodents their teeth grow throughout their whole life continuously. So the only way they can keep their teeth under control, their teeth would just grow to a point where they wouldn't be able to chew or open their mouth or whatever. So the only way they can keep that under control is to constantly be grinding them against something. And same with rats, same with mice. Beavers are that way. And beavers have this orange, a thick enamel that gives their teeth kind of an orange color. And as you know, they, of course, chew on trees. And interestingly, they can, you know, most of us can't digest the what they call lignin or whatever, the material that's inside of plant, like bark and tree material. Beavers can actually digest that, so they're not, it's, you know, you think of them as knocking a tree down in order to make their lodge and stuff or to alter their environment, but they also can digest that kind of plant material. And they are exclusively plant-eating animals. So like in their dens, they don't hibernate, they don't migrate, you know, they're there all winter, and they will bring food into the den, plant food, and store it there for the winter. So that the tail that you're all familiar with is it's used for a balance in addition to a bunch of other things. It helps them to swim, of course, and you've all seen the alert it gives out with its tail. So here's a picture of a beaver taking some material back to its den, but it's unlikely that this is food material. This is more likely building material, I should think, maybe for nesting. Because it doesn't look to me like digestible food material. You'll see these up and down the river, all over the place, where, you know, they're either starting working on a tree or they've brought a tree down. This is, of course, a beaver lodge. Now, the interesting thing about a beaver lodge is they construct them in a way that the entrance is only underwater. So you can't enter it any way other than underwater. But underneath this lodge, there is a portion where they come up out of the water because, you know, beavers aren't, they're not fish. They still breathe air. They can go underwater for long periods, but they still need to breathe air. So inside the lodge is like a little room, but you can only enter that up through the water. Also, beavers have amazing vocalizations. I don't know if I once saw a little documentary on beavers on cable somewhere, and it was amazing, the vocalizations they make. If you ever get a chance to see that documentary, do it. So they're monogamous, like a lot of the animals that we've been talking about. They are monogamous, although I am going to talk about a few that aren't for the first time, I think, ever. They mate at 3 years old, and, you know, they'll have 1 to 4 babies, which stay, you know, with the parent in the lodge. I don't know for exactly how long. And, you know, they're mainly active at night, which is why it's a little bit difficult. You'll see them in the day. It's not like they're not out there, but their primary activity is at night. So if you want to take a kayak trip sometime and you really want to see the beaver in the middle of the summer, hit the water at 5 a.m, you know, just when the light's starting, and then go out, and then there'll be a lot of, you know, activity out there. So I said, you know, they can stay underwater for quite a while. They can go 15 minutes. It's pretty long to hold your breath. The otter, I think, was 8 minutes or something. And of course, they're very social and very vocal.
Hey, quick question, dude. When they're bringing down a tree or working on a tree, do they work in together? Or is it just one beaver?
No, because I've even watched one of them working on a tree, and it's just a one.
Yeah.
Yeah. Now, I can't say that's always the case, but I've actually seen a beaver one morning. I went out and I saw him up on the shore and he was working on a tree. So this is the way you'll see 90% of the time. You'll see a beaver 90% of the time either this way, or you'll be going along and you'll hear that and you'll look and there's nothing there because they see you before you see them, I would say, most of the time. So this guy didn't know I was there until he did. And of course, you know, the speculation is that that's for one or both of two things. Either they're trying to startle this predator that might try to attack them, and that'll give them the few extra seconds to get away, or that they are warning the other beavers around. And like I said, you go out at 5 o'clock, and sometimes you'll see four or five beavers out there, and then when one hears you, that's it. They're all gone. This is a beaver grooming, and this one you can see is a big boy. He sat there for probably 20 minutes grooming himself while I took pictures. Now, this is one of the rare examples where I'm not on the river. I'm actually walking my dog along the lake, and I'm trying to hold the dog and film this guy for like 20 minutes. But he basically just did that for 20 minutes.
Your dog?
Either didn't know or didn't care. I don't know which one it was.
He didn't care. I used to get it every time people would walk over the bridge at the end of Harvard Road. They'd be walking and he was way down there and slap, 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 slap.
Right.
There's no one here. They didn't seem to find the dog.
Well, this guy, interestingly enough, so this was at the causeway, you know, on Barton Road, where they dammed up the Lake Boone. This is the reason there is a Lake Boone. There used to be a Lake Boone Pond. Now there's Lake Boone because they dammed it up at the causeway on Barton Road. So I started walking on the beginning of the causeway and I saw the beaver out in the lake swimming. And I thought, because I've seen this once before where the road had like water across it. So there, I assumed at the time a beaver must have either come from the river up into the lake or from the lake down into the river. And it went, you know, over this causeway. So I watched this beaver thinking, oh, he's gonna do that. This will be cool. I'll get to watch him do that. He didn't. He swam the whole way while I stood there, came up on the shore and just groomed himself for like 20 minutes. Okay, so a beaver. One thing you'll see with the beaver, let's see if we can go back up for a minute. So if you notice with the beaver, they swim with almost all of their body underwater. Now, you know, that's kind of a generalization. Sometimes you'll see a little bit of the body, but most of the time, all you see is the head. So If you're looking, you know, I say, okay, that's 44 pounds and the muskrat's 4 pounds, and obviously you should be able to tell the difference. Well, that's not always obvious because you don't have anything to compare it to. It's not like the muskrat's sitting next to the beaver and obviously that's the muskrat. One of the ways to tell a muskrat from a beaver is that they keep their whole body above water with the exception of their tail. So they do have a tail that they use almost exclusively as their propulsion device when they're swimming. Like the beaver, they just eat vegetation. And so you can see how he's all the way out of the water. Well, you can see his whole body is what I should phrase it as. They also tend, I think, to be a little bit slower swimming in the water, so if you're trying to tell the difference, but even then, half the time I see something in the distance, I don't know which it is. This guy didn't know I was there until he did. And at one point, he decides maybe it's safer to leave. So, They also can be underwater for 15 minutes, like the beaver, so pretty good set of lungs on them, I guess. they live with the family. They all live together, you know, like the young will live in there. They also do burrows into the bank, the shore of the river, but they supposedly make these like mud mounds. And I see mud mounds all the time, and I assume that they're muskrats, but I don't really know. Some of them are very big, and so I'm not sure I thought I had a picture of one of the mud mounds. I have one that I posted recently on the thing with all the turtles on it, and I think that's a muskrat's mud mound, but it's so big, I don't know. I mean, it's a 4-pound animal, and it's, you know, the mound is big. Maybe, I don't know, could be. And the other interesting thing is it's right next to where the swan, remember last year's swan, the whole saga, oh, here's the babies, and then the babies kept getting killed. The nest where that swan gave birth to all the babies is right where that mud mound is. So I don't know if, I don't know, anyhow. I see a lot of them, and I'm just never sure if that's what I'm seeing. So, interestingly, I didn't make any notes on the raccoon, but raccoon, this one I came upon, again, all of them are really early in the morning, and look at the beautiful coloring on that mama, and then her little baby, she's going like, hey, come on, let's go, and he's like, you know, do-de-do. He doesn't seem to be in any rush. This is a family of them early in the morning. You'll see a lot of head butting and wrestling, and I don't know if it's playing or fighting. And one kind of seems like a bit of a bully. Now, this isn't technically an aquatic mammal, you know, but they do go down to the water a lot. You've read about how they like to wash their food and stuff. I'm pretty sure in the next one, you'll see one of the babies catch something, and it looks like it's washing it and eating it. It's a long, long video of wrestling. So if you look at this one on the left, I think you'll see how he's got something? And he kind of takes it away because he doesn't want the other one getting it. And then the other one finally figures out he's got something, and then he starts fighting him for it. But I think the guy gets away with it in the end.
So are they good swimmers, do you know?
I don't know if they swim at all. It's a good question. I let me put it this way, I've never seen them in the water. So I just thought those were worth looking at. And then this one is likewise is not an aquatic mammal, but I didn't know how many of you get to see a fisher, so I thought I'd put this up. This is maybe 20 or 30 feet from the water. So I see this guy periodically in this section. But again, I was walking the dog, and I'm trying to hold the big dog. I'm trying to hold it back while I'm trying to take a picture. And this fisher, I don't know why he didn't take off. He was trying to climb this little narrow tree, and but it was a challenge to get a picture and make sure the dog didn't get attacked and the fisher didn't get attacked. Oh, fisher. This is the fun thing about a fisher. They are the only predators of the porcupine. Mm-hmm. So they flip the porcupine over, and or do they attack the head? I've forgotten now which, but it's the only predator of a porcupine.
Are they related to otters?
Yeah, that's another good question. I don't know. I mean, I don't think they're in the weasel family, but maybe they are. I could be wrong. But I mean, they're pretty good sized animals.
They sort of resemble the otter on land.
But if they were in the weasel family, I would think they'd have to be up there with the biggest too, because they're pretty big. I think I have a video here. It's a terrible video, but it shows an agitated fisher that I was trying to get a video of, and it didn't want me. Yeah, so you can see him down at the bottom. It's a really terrible, now he stands up to try and show me how big and fierce he is. And his tail is flicking like he's pretty agitated. Anyhow, I don't really have much to say about the fishers other than I had these couple of pictures I thought they might be of interest. So I'm gonna cover the three, what I call the three kind of in-your-face birds out in the river of the songbirds. And of course, the granddaddy of them is the red-winged blackbird. This bird lets you know the whole time you're out there. It's an aggressive bird, aggressive territorially, aggressive if it's got a nest nearby. It's constantly chattering at you as you're going by. But it's also one of the more colorful birds. And like many of the birds we talked about before, the red-winged blackbird, it has that sexual dimorphism. So the male looks very flashy, whereas the female is quite understated. You know, it stays down in the brush and it kind of, other than when it's trying to protect. And by the way, unlike some where the male is the only protector, the male and female will go after predators and things like that to try and protect their nests. I think this is also, the reason I put this picture up here is I think it's interesting. You know, everybody when they see the red wing, they immediately, oh, red wing blackbird. But sometimes when you see just the white stripe, you don't realize that it's a red wing blackbird. Because they have the ability to cover that red part on their wing. And sometimes you'll even see them, you won't see any color, you just see the black. This is the way you'll see maybe 90% of the time out in the, they're always on a cattail stalk. And the male will try to be in this elevated position most of the time because it's trying to protect a certain amount of territory. And this, I find this kind of weird. So the female will nest down below and the male will be up high trying to look for predators, look for danger, things like that. But the male has a territory that will often have as many as five females nesting within it. And they're not monogamous, they're polygamous. But the interesting thing is they say, like, when they go and check the genetics of all these eggs, like 25% of them don't come from this male. So the female is actually being mated by somebody else, but in that male's territory. And it's just it's an interesting kind of mix of that kind of territoriality. Very dramatic looking bird, and the one in the middle is, again, like I said, that's the way 90% of the time they're letting you know they don't like that you're around. So, like I said, so here's the female. In this particular picture, she actually looks pretty, pretty almost, I wouldn't call it colorful, but kind of striking. A lot of the times you'll see them from the side and they just look very dull and sort of, you know, blend in with the background. But you can see how they don't look at all like the male. So this is me coming up. I pulled up along the shore and clearly they have a nest nearby and they were taking turns coming at me, the male and the female. And the one I just showed you was the male taking his turn. And he's like trying to scare me away, you know. So I'm assuming somewhere in this area, because the female was kind of up in this bush somewhere, coming in and out and attacking me. Not when I say attacking me, sort of really attacking. They were doing like that, you know. Oh, we're scary. Look out. Oh, and this is what we talked about last time, about some of these birds will attack the bigger raptors. So if they think this particular case looks like a red-winged hawk, red-tailed hawk, I mean, but you can see, normally I wouldn't even, this is so far away, I wouldn't even be able to tell who's attacking what, but you can see this guy is a red-winged blackbird. And it's the same event there. So they will attack, and sometimes they'll gang attack. You'll sometimes see, especially the littler birds, you'll see like half a dozen of them are trailing and harassing one of the hawks or eagles or something. And one of the birds we'll do in a minute, the kingbird, will also do that. They're very protective of their nest.
You never see the hawk turn around and get the small bird. What's that? And then they'll come to my feet or take away a dove, so you know.
I know, exactly, right? You're thinking, like, why are you running away from the small bird? Shouldn't that be dinner? and so red-winged blackbirds, they mostly eat insects and seeds, so they will come to your bird feeder. You know, while they're out on the river and they really like to be out there, there are also many other places. It's not like red-winged blackbird is only on the river. And so, like I said, you'll see them at your feeders. So this is probably my favorite of the songbirds out on the river, are the swallows. These guys, if you just go out and sit in the middle of the pond and just watch their aerial acrobatics, these birds are crazy. I love watching them. I could just sit there for like an hour and just watch them swoop. They're one of the kinds of birds that eat on the wing, as they call it. So you know, they're just diving around, they're grabbing insects and just eating them and continuing to go. And interestingly, you'll see they'll come swooping down, and they'll be, you know, they'll look like they're like a half inch off the water. Well, as it turns out, not only are they, you know, feeding on insects that way, but also they will drink and bathe that way. So they don't stop like to bathe. They just hit the water and then shake it off, or they'll grab water in their beak as they go by. These are amazing birds. Now, there's basically three of the main types of swallows out there in the river. So there's a tree swallow, there's the barn swallow, and the bank swallow. The bank swallow is smaller. I don't think I see them as much. And I really struggle telling the difference between the tree swallow and the barn swallow. Now, the barn swallow should be obvious because it often has a very reddish-brownish breast, and you can kind of see, this is a juvenile, you can kind of see it starting to get that, but it can be a lot darker than that. And so it should be a lot easier because the tree swallow is bright white. So, oh, that should be a quick giveaway. But then you start looking at all the variations and you realize they don't always, you know, these guys sometimes are whiter and they don't always have the red, and you got to look for a little band here. It doesn't have the band or the pointed tail versus, and I really struggled to figure out which one's which, but I like them all. Again, a baby, probably most likely barn swallow. So barn swallows and tree swallows are roughly the same size. Barn swallow is like 7 inches, tree swallow is like 6 inches. They're kind of pretty much the same. I think so. I think it's head to tail, I think. Good question, though. I don't know the answer to that. So one of the ways you're supposed to be able to tell a barn swallow from a tree swallow is that they're much pointier forked tail. So a lot of times, and that's actually one of the things I really like about swallows, when you're watching them fly, they have that like arrow-like wings and that forked pointy tail. It's like a really cool look, I think.
Is a chimney swift, is there such a group of swifts? They're not swallows. I guess I lumped them in with...
No, these are different. So this, like I said, there's...
together, all the swallows,
yeah,
and the swift, so I guess I thought, but is there a category of birds that swift
belong? Well, I'm not a birder, so you're coming to the wrong guy on that one. Like I said, I'm having trouble telling those two apart, much less...
Well, Well, they move so fast. They don't sit there and say, look.
These are crazy fast movers. So in a minute, I got some slow-mos. It's the only way that you'll be able to see them. Again, another thing I love about them is that they have no neck, basically. They just have that squatty head. These are all juveniles that I'm showing you. I almost never can get a picture of a swallow because either they're screaming by or they're not visible anywhere. It's not like they sit and perch on a branch for me to take a picture of. I just happened to get this series of babies who just sat there, I guess because they were babies and they didn't know what to do. And so they let me take video, they let me take still pictures. And here's three or four of them together.
That's a great shot.
Yeah, great shots.
And here they are live. A little blurry, but what are you gonna do when you're in a kayak, right?
Right.
Now, this was one of the only times I actually saw some perched. And so I was able to get one or two pictures before they flew off. They're not super great pictures. And again, I'm assuming they're barn swallows, not because I see a lot of red here, but because of this like bib. Whereas every time I see pictures of a tree swallow, it's white all the way up, right up to the, you know, right up to the head. And so I'm guessing again that these are barn swallows. But this isn't why I like swallows. I like them for this, for the flying. This, again, I'm assuming is a barn swallow for one reason. They say barn swallows are faster flyers, and they don't glide. You know how a lot of birds, especially like the raptors and stuff, you'll see that they'll flap, and then they'll just sort of glide around. Apparently, barn swallows, they don't glide. It's always either they're flapping or they, you know, they're like a missile. They got like their wings back, and I have a couple pictures where it just looks like a missile going across. Again, assumption of barn swallow because of the long, you know, pointy tail. And look, a little red-winged blackbird photobombed me on that one. Same kind of stuff. Now, in this one here, you can definitely see that forked tail, even though it's a little blurry, but I don't know if your eyes are good, you can see it's got that very forked tail. But if one of you guys were a birder and you said, oh no, these are tree swallows or something else, I would say, okay, because I'm not good at this. All right, so I slow-moed this guy. He's right here. He's coming in into your view, but you'll see him bigger in a minute. So, you see how he never holds his wings flat. He either has them back or he's flapping them.
That picture makes it look so big.
Yeah, it looks huge.
Really?
Well, I can blow it up. That's probably one of the reasons why it looks bigger. Again, like I said, they're about 7 inches, that bird. So I slow-moed this guy. If I leave it in regular motion, I can't keep up with them, and it's no good for you guys to see. But that's the best way to actually see it, be out there and just see them diving and swooping and all over the place. Okay, so let me add a couple of things to the tree swallow versus barn swallow. So the barn swallow, of course, got their name because they like to nest in barns. But basically what they prefer is some kind of overhang. So they might go under a bridge or some other structure that, you know, had an overhang where they could get their nest protected. Whereas the tree swallow, I guess so named, because it goes into abandoned holes in trees. So, you know, maybe an old woodpecker hole or something, it'll go in and make its nest. And the tree swallow, so again, the tree swallow and the barn swallow tend to have a blue back. The tree swallow, very iridescent blue, but the tree swallow has the white front, and the barn swallow should have like kind of a red, not reddish, but like a brownish, orangish sort of front. The while the barn swallow will, you'll see it sometimes, or it won't glide at all. The tree swallow is one of the few swallows that will do some gliding. Makes it a little bit different. Let's see. Okay, so eastern kingbird. This is the last of my birds, but I do have a couple of bonuses at the end. Eastern kingbird is kind of a fun bird. It's not quite as prevalent as the other two. The other two you'll see all the time, all over the place. The kingbird has a slightly bigger territory. They're very territorial. They will protect their territory from other kingbirds. And again, the male and female will both protect, not just the male. And they will protect it not only against other kingbirds, but they'll protect the nest against the bigger birds, the raptors. There's apparently like tree snakes that'll go after their eggs and things like that, but they're very protective. The thing I love about this, so the kingbird, you notice his head is blacker than the rest of his back. His back tends to be very gray, and the head is kind of a black, and then the front is all white. I don't have a great picture of the front. I'll show you in the next one. So you can see the one over on the left. It's all white in the front. So they sometimes describe him as like a businessman in a suit. He's got like the gray sport or suit jacket and the white shirt. There's also, this is interesting, and I don't know if I've ever actually seen a picture of it, but supposedly in this black head somewhere, there is a red patch that they almost never show. And I don't know under what situation they show it, if it's like to frighten thing or whatever, but they do actually have some red in there somewhere that you rarely get to see. This was interesting. I read this. So I said they're fiercely territorial, especially against other kingbirds. They'll go out and have midair fights, and apparently they'll lock feet and try to pull the other one's feathers out, which I think is pretty interesting. And so these guys, they're called flycatchers, you know. So most of the food they get, the insects, they catch in midair, and if it's a small one, they just eat it. If it's a large one, apparently they bring it back to their perch or whatever and try to beat the crap out of it until it can easily be swallowed. So they're very active flyers, kind of like we said with the barn swallow, where they don't really glide. They're always flapping their wings to fly. But occasionally they will go against the wind and sort of do this kind of hover, almost like an osprey will do a hover. And they'll do that to try and spot an insect that maybe is on a plant and then dive down on it.
Do you ever see
an
osprey while you're out there?
Ospreys, oh yeah. In fact, I said in the last talk, when I was doing the raptors, I said, I've been wanting to get the osprey hovering and diving, and I never got it. I got the one where he dove from the tree, but not hovering. And I'd seen it, I just had never gotten a video. I finally got that like a week ago. So I have the osprey hovering and then diving. All right, I'm going to update you on a couple things from previous ones. So we talked about the last time when we did the raptors, I showed the eagle in the nest. I thought it was messing with something, but I didn't see any babies. Okay, so on the 13th, this must have been days after I gave the talk, I got the baby. Unfortunately, there's only one. You know, the last 2 years at least, they've had two babies each time. I only see one in there. And so that was the 13th. Here's the 21st. I still see them. But since the 21st, every time I go by, I have not seen the baby. And I'm not sure if I'm just getting the wrong time, because, you know, I'm coming from an angle. Well, you know, the baby could easily be in the nest and I wouldn't know. He has to be kind of sticking his head up for me to know. So I'm not sure, did something happen to the baby? Did it die? Or am I just getting the wrong time each time?
Depends. So, the one that's born first is a little bigger and it will kill the younger one.
Could be, yeah.
It's a lot.
Although, again, with the last 2 years, the two previous years, there were two and they both made it all the way to adulthood. And this one, like I said, I've seen him as a tiny baby right off the bat. Now, I do know sometimes very small ones will kill the other ones. I'm not even going to tell that story. Never mind. It's too gross. Okay, so I went out yesterday, and this is really going to be stretching it. Like I said, I haven't been able to see it. So I took a whole bunch of pictures, because sometimes I'll take them, I'll blow them up, and I'll see. Can I see? Is there something in there? You know, maybe I just was missing it. Same angle, minutes apart. This, to me, looks like something that's not here or is much lower. Like, look at how it's all the way up to this stick. And here's that same stick, and it's not there. So I'm hoping maybe that's, you know, that it's in there and it was just resting at a certain angle or something. But I don't know at this point whether the baby's still alive or not. Now for the Swan Saga. So we talked in the first talk about the swans, and you know, there was the one couple, the mating pair, they had babies, all the babies got killed, and the father, I assume it was the father, disappeared at the same time. All that happened within, three of the babies and the father all disappeared within like 1 to 2 weeks. The remaining baby stayed with the mom, everything seemed good, and I'm assuming it's the mom, I can't tell the difference between the mom and the dad. It seemed good, and then like it was a month and a half later, finally the last baby was dead. So the mom was out there in the pond for a couple of months, and then another swan came, so by fall it seemed like there was another mating pair on the pond, that seemed good. Early this year, I assume it's the same mating pair, they're out in the pond, everything seems good. I even thought I saw where you might have seen from one of the earlier posts, I thought I saw where the female was nesting this year, although I haven't seen any signs of that since. Everything seemed fine. On the 20th, so was that like 2 weeks ago? I'm paddling up, and all of a sudden I see four swans. And they're not fighting, and that's unusual because they're very territorial. And I've videoed them fighting before. And they're not fighting, and I see what looks like another swan nesting. And I'm thinking, what is going on? Like, how could there be two pairs? And I mean, they just wouldn't allow that to happen. They would fight it out. Well, this is a dead swan, and this, I'm assuming, is the grieving mate. So I think there must have been a fight. I'm speculating and anthropomorphizing to some degree, but I'm assuming there was a fight and one of the males got killed. Right after I paddled by this, I stopped up at the pond, and one of the swans swam by and went off. So I'm assuming this is the female whose mate was killed, and she's going off, and there's the mate. So I thought, okay, well, I guess, you know, those things happen. I'm not surprised, territoriality and all that. But then I've been watching the two out in the pond. They've been fine. Everything's fine. Here they are a couple days ago, 2 days ago. They're out in the pond. Everything's fine. Yesterday, there's only one in the pond, and then I find this one floating down upstream or downstream. So, no idea what killed this one, but it looks like my mating pair is no longer a pair. So now I'm gonna have to wait and see if she gets in. Again, I'm assuming it's a she. It could be that he is still there. I can't tell the difference between the male and the female. I think I said this before, but supposedly especially during mating season. I think this is probably the male because they get this knob that they both have above their beak gets bigger on the male in mating season. So, it's not like I fished this guy out to see what his knob looked like.
Are they too big for snappers to get at that size?
I would guess.
Their snapper would take it anyway, take the whole thing away anyway, right?
Maybe. I mean, I'd be surprised if a snapper could get them.
Yeah, I think it's a little big for snappers.
They're pretty big. The right. Swans are big.
Yeah.
But I can't rule it out. I'll say another thing. So I had speculated, if you guys remember, that when the babies were getting killed or disappearing is what I should say, because I never actually saw any dead babies. I was speculating that it was the otters coming up from underneath and grabbing them. But when I talked to this guy who was telling me the story, you know, about the shooting the swans, he told me that last year he swears that when that nest, remember the nest came down at one point, that there was a full goose carcass up there that the eagles were feeding on. And I thought, man, I didn't know eagles would attack them. Like, I've seen an eagle attack an adult goose, but I just assumed it was harassing it to get it away from the babies or something like that, or, you know, something else. I didn't think it was actually food. But he said he believes he has a full, saw a full goose carcass up there. So the question is, could an eagle attack the swan? I don't know, because they're not eating it. It's the whole body's there.
Is there poison in that one?
Well, I wouldn't think so. You know, the reason they think the eagles get poisoned is because of the rodenticide. You know, it gets into the animals that they're eating, whereas the swans are only eating vegetation, so it would require a pretty hefty dose of poison, because it would mean the whole environment would be poisoned, as opposed to just eating a poison. And, you know, something like an eagle will eat a dead animal. So you could have an animal that got killed by a rodenticide, and then the eagle would eat it.
The swallows don't eat fish?
No.
So it wasn't, though, that we were competing with the eagle?
Oh, are you talking about a swallow or a swan?
I'm sorry.
Yeah. No, the swans only eat vegetation. Supposedly, they can eat 8 pounds a day. Can you believe that? 8 pounds a day. Good question. I probably had that in one of my previous talks, but a lot of poundage.
Yeah.
We've had swans for many years. I don't recall them getting attacked like that.
Yeah.
But we haven't had eagles for many years.
Well,
those.
The other thing too is, remember, unless you're following these guys every day, kind of like I'm doing, I'm not every day, but you know what I mean, like very frequently, you wouldn't know, because you'll see a swan, you go, oh, the swan's there. And then a month later, you'll see two swans, you go, oh, yeah, there's the swans. But really, like I said, the one swan was partnerless for a couple months, and then the other one came in. There's so many swans that one will find its way and they'll pair up, and then they'll protect that territory. And then if one of them dies, same thing will happen. You know, another one will move in. And I think we talked about this last time. The interesting thing about the swan is, if one swan disappears from a mating pair, regardless of if it leaves, if it's killed, whatever, if one swan disappears and another swan comes, the older swan will determine what the territory will be. So for example, if the female is there in the pond that I'm in, if she's the surviving one, and a younger male comes, they'll take up that territory. If an older male comes, she'll go to his territory. So I think that's kind of interesting.
Sounds like people.
Yeah.
Respect for the elderly. You sound like you have a drone?
A drone? No.
because my son gives some pretty good camera. It sounded like you would be a great candidate for a drone, because in that case, a nest, you could fly up above.
Yeah, right. I would love to have one of those. You know, you see those nest cams all the time. Like if you go down to the Sudbury Bird, was it Birds Unlimited or whatever, they now have an eagle cam in there all the time going. And you know, so then you see the little fuzzy babies, and it's kind of fun. Yeah. That would be fun. Although, I don't know, a drone might be interesting if the eagle attacked the drone. You know?
Our deck overlooks a small pond that kind of feeds into Elizabeth Brook.
Mm-hmm.
And there's a lot of stuff that goes on in that pond. And occasionally, there'll be a lot of stirring up in the water. A lot of up and down and back and around. And I think that, like, there's got to be more than one animal in there. And then...
is it just... like for a 2-week period during the year?
Yes.
Well, then I know exactly what it is.
What is it?
It's the carp.
The carp?
Really? No, it was an animal because
it came
to the surface and it had stuff in its mouth and it was
Maybe it's an otter.
You're talking about the river otter?
Well, that's what people told us it was, but could I was going to let him determine.
Well, it could be if you've seen that. But I'll tell you.
I saw his mouth and his head. Occasionally, but it was just for a small time, and then they were gone. I figured they ate up all the fish, and it's not a very big pond.
Yeah.
They probably ate up all the fish and went back down the river.
Yeah, they're pretty efficient hunters.
About 4 feet long, and it goes.
Oh. Well, if it's doing that, that's probably an otter. But yeah. 4 feet long doesn't make it not a carp, believe it or not. Because if you take your kayak out to the big pond along the river for about a 2-week period, roughly, maybe even a little less, it's like Jaws out there. You have, it's unbelievable what those carp are doing, and they're huge. Like they're banging up against my kayak, they're thrashing around all over the place. It's actually crazy. You got to experience it to believe.
And then they'll be gone after.
Oh yeah. Well, because it's just they're spawning. They're all crazy because they're spawning, you know. And then after that, they're just all docile. You know, you don't even see them. They're kind of down in the weeds. But I actually have some videos of that. Actually, if you've seen the movie that I showed, do you guys see that movie that I showed? It's like a 3-minute movie. That one has the carp in it, but it's, you know, everything is only for a couple of seconds during the movie. So it may not be as satisfying, but if you watch this, you'll see, and usually I'm focusing on one carp, but if you're sitting in the middle of the pond, there's like 20 or 30 of them doing this. And so it's crazy. It's madness out there. It's maybe midway through, you'll see it.
And what are the carp eating?
What are the carp eating? I don't know. I'm imagining vegetation. So if you see a bunch of thrashing water, that's the carp. There it is.
Oh, yeah. And you can see a
bit
or something. No,
yeah. And that's not a very, that doesn't look very dramatic because I zoomed in on one animal, but you, when you got the whole pond doing that.
A carp is an invasive species that they introduced.
Yeah, and they're very effective out there. Like I said, they get huge and there's lots of them.
Watching the Lord.
Yeah, if it's eating a fish, it's got to be the otter, because, you know, muskrats and beavers aren't going to be eating animals.
Do they have a fast pattern of going through these small streams?
Well, they don't. They don't have to.
We're talking about the corner of 117 and Hudson Road.
They don't have to stay in the water. I mean, they can go in and out. You know, they're like a weasel. I mean, a weasel will be out in the land too. They're just most comfortable in the water. That's where they're, you know, most effective.
Safer.
Yeah, much safer.
Are you allowed to say where the eagle nest is?
Yeah, it's right there at Collins.
Where?
Collins Foundation. You know where Collins is, right? The American Heritage Museum.
Well, last.
There it is, right there. That's the baby.
Yeah, a couple days ago I was at the Honey Pot.
It's right across from Honey Pot.
Where? Okay, it's on the Collins side.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, if you see a big field across from Honey Pot, across the river, with a lot of geese in the field, mm-hmm. the eagle's nest is right above it. No, it's a tree. So eagles always make their nest just below the canopy. So it's right up at the top near the canopy, but just below it of a conifer, usually like a pine in our case, a white pine. And so it's easy for them to get in and out, but it's not like an osprey where there's nothing above. You know, they make a nest and there's nothing above them because the osprey needs that for its flying ability, whereas the eagle's a little more. Yeah, eagle's a little more adept at flying than an osprey. It's right on their property, but right on the edge of the river.
Good place.
So if you go out in a kayak, you can see it. And I don't think it's the only one in the area. I think there's one or two others around somewhere. I don't know where. Yeah, maybe. I know there was one in like Billerica, one in Framingham or something.
One in Waltham,
yeah. So I think they're starting to come around. But this one's been up there for at least three, and could be, I'd say at least four, but it could be even many years more than that because I wasn't following it before that. Anyhow, that's it.